Welcome to Fighting Over the VCR, the podcast where we discuss movies we grew up watching. My name is Matthew.
My name is Nancy.
And this week we have our special guest, Sherry.
Hey there.
We're going to be talking about a couple movies that are really important to us growing up and from a very important filmmaker named John Hughes. Part of the reason why we're doing this not only is for our love of John Hughes, but it's kind of special for one of our podcast team members, Nancy, because she has a birthday coming up and she wanted to do this as kind of a special thing. So happy birthday. Everyone tell Nancy happy birthday.
Yay, happy birthday.
Thank you.
It's not her birthday today.
No.
But maybe you might listen to this on her birthday.
Possible.
It's possible. We're not going to say what her birthday is. So when you listen to it, just say happy birthday. And it'll be kind of cool to be like, hey, happy birthday.
Thanks, Matt.
So anyway, we're going to be doing this special episode talking about three John Hughes movies. And we're going to do it kind of chronologically. We're going to talk about 16 Candles, The Breakfast Club, and Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which are three of what I consider like the five 80s teen high school comedies that he's done. Near the end of the episode, we're going to have kind of an open discussion. We might mention Some Kind of Wonderful and Weird Science, because I think we all also enjoy those. Mm-hmm. But trying to keep it kind of easy on you guys and stick to these three movies, because they're probably the three most popular of those five, I would say.
Oh, yeah.
I agree.
They're the better films, I'd say.
And but we'll talk about that more later. So first, we're going to get started, and Nancy's going to kick us off talking a little bit about 16 Candles.
So 16 Candles came out in 1984, and it starred Molly Ringwald. She was, you know, John Hughes' kind of like little darling for several films. Anthony Michael Hall, the very attractive Michael Schauffling as Jake Ryan, special appearance with John Cusack as one of the nerds.
And Joan Cusack.
They get to be brother and sister. Joan. No, they're not they're not playing brother and sister in this movie, but they do star in it together. This movie set, I think, like fall of Molly Ringwald's sophomore year of high school, and it takes place on her 16th birthday. The day before her sister's wedding, and everybody in her family forgets about her birthday. And, you know, from the very moment that this movie starts, she's so excited about turning 16, and she's like on the phone with a girlfriend. She's kind of like looking in the mirror, like, oh my God, what's different about me? And kind of doing a assessment. Turns out she doesn't really notice anything different, but she certainly notices that everyone in her family has completely forgotten that it's her birthday, and she thinks it's like a joke.
Yeah.
And through the course of all this, you know, there's a school dance, and she's got this huge crush on Jake Ryan, and there's a geek played by Anthony Michael Hall who's kind of following her around or just like won't leave her alone.
I find it funny, like, he has a name, like his name is, they call him Farmer Ted. But they always...
In the credits, he's the geek.
He's the geek. Yeah. And everywhere it is, he's the geek.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Joan Cusack is a girl geek. Like, that's
yeah.
her.
Yeah.
It's really bizarre. But he, you know, he's a freshman and he's hilarious. But, you know, you really get to see this kind of exaggerated experience of, you know, her, you know, her kind of sophomore experience and, you know, having a crush on a senior boy, but also that it is her 16th birthday and what it feels like to be completely forgotten about. And, you know, the wedding that her sister is having is just totally ridiculous. We get another appearance from our favorite clairvoyant from Poltergeist, Tangina or Tangina, however you want to pronounce her name. And it's a very silly movie. It's got an excellent soundtrack. The movie is full of music that's just so freaking good. But it's one of the best, very silly high school movies. But it also, for the course of our discussion, is a movie that I think both Sherry and I in particular feel strongly about, because one, this would never happen to us. Sherry and I both enjoy our birthdays enough, and
Nightmare.
We both like to celebrate our birthdays. So people around us would not forget that our birthdays are coming up. It's just impossible. But I think as a kid watching this...
constantly remind them.
Yeah, I think as kids watching this, we were both kind of like, that could happen. There's no way that could actually happen, right?
Is that why you are so vocal about your birthday? Like,
I don't know, but I mean...
Because growing up, you were definitely like, it's my birthday! But as like you've gotten older, you know, it's petered off a little bit, but when the day comes, you really, I mean, you don't really like to.
I'm not embarrassed. You don't
like people to forget.
Well, yeah, and I'm not embarrassed when people sing to me in a restaurant.
Oh,
like
no,
that doesn't bother me at all.
Neither am I. Nancy's favorite question is, "Can I see your ID?"
Well, yeah, that I think that's most women's favorite question, especially if they're like over 30.
But you're very vocal about, like, that's my favorite question.
No, it really is. That's the favorite. Yeah.
And if it's your birthday, then all the more the merrier. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
Shocked that the Sagittarius and the Scorpio like their birthdays.
I know.
Matt doesn't dislike his birthday, but he's not.
I'm indifferent about my birthday.
He likes having a celebration, but he's just like, whatever.
Yeah.
I think that birthdays are great and they're fun, but at the same time, I also understand why some people just think it's another day. They get depressed while they're getting older.
Of course.
All those kinds of things. But for Sam in this movie, I mean, anyone who is any age listening to this would know, like, 16 has kind of become like this monumental birthday because of either getting your driver's license or whatever. And she is like, she feels like it should be important.
Well, and especially for girls, it's like a... used to make a big to-do of it, right? Like, sweet 16, you know, supposed to be, there's songs about it, you know. She has a big crush, which is another part of it. Like, I know Nancy, like, high school crush, you know, then the whole forgetting the birthday thing can relate. Yeah.
Sherry and I also have another very special connection regarding this movie in that we both know what it's like for a family member or a very close friend to decide to have their wedding the day before our birthdays. And this didn't happen to us until our late 30s. It wasn't the same year, because I'm 3 years older than Sherry. But and it happened to me first, and then a few years later, it happened to Sherry. And I'll tell you, it really made me grouchy that year. My birthday that year was kind of like, well, Nancy, seriously? Like, why is this person getting married the day before my birthday? Like, it kind of ruined my whole birthday weekend. So I completely understand what Samantha Baker is feeling like.
Well, and you always kind of get that anyway because
of Thanksgiving. It falls on Thanksgiving.
Like, it either falls on it or right around Thanksgiving. Yeah. And it ends up being like, hey, we're all going to get together for Thanksgiving. Oh, by the way, let's have cake.
Yeah, I mean, my birthday's in November 23rd, if anyone cares.
Please tell her happy birthday.
Exactly. Harry's character in the number 23 cares.
Exactly. But yeah, so every like 5 or 6 years, it rotates and falls on Thanksgiving, you know, so it's always like a busy weekend or whatever. But yes, Sherry and I both really know what it's like to have a family or friend decide their wedding is going to be like the day before your birthday. And it's like, thanks. Great. And to the family member and close friend of ours that you know who you are. If you're listening, you know who you are.
We still love you.
We still love you. But yeah, so again.
Weddings are hard to plan. And sometimes picking a day is complicated.
Absolutely.
I understand. Our wedding was on my grandpa's birthday. It was on his 80th birthday. So, hey. You know, I did it to somebody else, too.
And then we sang happy birthday.
We did.
He had an awesome birthday party,
by
the way.
He did. He had a lot of fun. He was happy.
People got married on his birthday at his party.
I know.
What a crazy thing.
I know.
So another fun thing about 16 Candles, which really connects for me and Matt, is since our podcast is a podcast where a brother and sister are talking about movies, this movie full on deals with siblings. And a lot of the multiple dynamics of siblings. I mean, there are four kids in this family. The relationships.
Wait, what's the fourth kid?
There's a youngest daughter.
Molly Ringwald's younger sister in real life plays Patty, the youngest sister.
Oh, and also, I know you guys know this, but I want to point this out that what's cool about this movie is Molly Ringwald was 15 when she did this movie. And so
she breaks
Anthony Michael Hall.
So she kind of breaks the pattern. Or she started out, like, doing the pattern right, and then they just snowballed into having 40-year-olds play high school kids later.
Right. Caroline is not 15. Ugh. Sorry, go ahead.
Caroline. Her sister?
No.
Jake's girlfriend.
Oh, yeah. No way. Yeah. But yeah, so because of this, because there's all these really intense sibling dynamics between Samantha and her sister who's getting married, and just how much of a monster her sister is to her and how insensitive she is, you know, and Samantha being the younger sister. But then all the problems she has with her younger brother, who's just such a douchebag.
Younger brothers? God. I
know. It's just extra fun to watch, you know, in context of us doing our podcast with all this kind of sibling rivalry that's happening in this movie.
You know, Sam, you're really acting like an asshole. And it just, her tone, like the whole movie, she has like this
very, so pretentious.
Like, pretentious monotone, the oldest sister, where I'm just kind of like, oh, just hit her with a car.
Don't worry. This girl doesn't know how to deal with cramps and decides to take 4 muscle relaxers and acts like a complete ass. This viewing, it was the first time I caught the quick little joke of Rudy standing at the altar saying, I bet everybody who thinks that we had to get married must be laughing at themselves now, thinking that she was pregnant and that's why they had to get married.
Right.
I know some people have really bad ones, but it's like, dude, 4? Like, come on. Ridiculous. Let's try some Advil.
Either way, we've talked about periods plenty on this podcast, so we're not going to go on and continue to talk about
them. Oh, do share.
No, we're good. Point of reference, listen to our Carrie episode. But this movie cracks me up. I mean, it certainly is an exaggerated view of, you know, like what this ideal high school couple is, because they show, you know, Jake and his perfect girlfriend who, you know, is beautiful and all that, but we see the dark side about her. I mean, he is fed up and bored with her. He hates how insensitive she is. You know, she ends up telling, you know, 100 people to come to his parents' house because they're not home, and they completely trash the house, and it just...
He said, yeah, she's totally insensitive.
She is totally insensitive. And doesn't know how to ask someone to open a door if her hair's caught in a door jam. I mean, you know, what are you doing, lady?
Bizarre. I have to say, I was telling Matt when we were watching it, that when that happens, while it seems ridiculous, I can see being drunk and going, what am I going to do? You need to cut my hair. But it's she had to be pretty bad.
Yeah. She's super bad. But there, and this movie, you know, gave birth to so many characters. And again, this movie came out in 1984. So it's really inappropriate in a lot of ways. I mean, how do we count the ways? But probably the most inappropriate depiction is Long Duck Dong.
Yeah.
I mean, they literally bang a gong every time they talk about him. So it's a little, it's very insensitive and, you know, not...
You can pretty much
dated in that way.
Well, yeah, you can look at a lot of like 80s movies. You could probably look at movies now and like we don't notice it now, but like in 15, 20 years we might notice it. Like there's
stuff even in The Hangover that hasn't like
hasn't aged well. It's not necessarily as PC.
Yeah.
You know, not with the times, but you know, also some people don't give a shit about stuff like that. So, you know, they just and some people, I mean, I'm not excusing it because I don't believe this, but some people just think like, oh, what's the big deal? It's a comedy. It's being humor. It's like, well, maybe you shouldn't be laughing changing. At that.
And I think so there's some consent issues in this movie too. They're not too bad in some of them, but I know.
I think
it's definitely, but you know, it.
I will say though, and as we watched all 3 of these movies for this episode, if we're looking at this movie through the eyes of Samantha Baker, it's possible that these kind of exaggerated depictions of like how weird her grandparents are. I mean, the fact that her grandma felt her up. That's very bizarre.
She's got her boobies.
I mean, that's so strange. The fact that, again, how awful her siblings were. I mean, especially her brother. Could just be that we're seeing this, like, filtered through her eyes.
That's a really good point. I never thought of it that way, where it's like, as John was writing this movie and directing it, he could have been like kind of exaggerating everything to be like, how would this world be through Samantha's eyes?
Yeah.
As if she was like telling the story herself from a diary or something.
I mean, it's not totally first person, because there's plenty of scenes where it's just the geek and his friends, or the geek with Jake. Cause what a weird pairing that Jake and the geek end up connected in some weird way simply because of Samantha. You know, Jake goes up to the geek to say, what do you know about her? And he just kind of freaks out, like, oh, no, I didn't know she was with you. I didn't mean to be dancing with her. And he's like, no, I just have some questions. It's fine. Calm down. But then throughout the movie, they kind of stay connected in a bizarre way. So we're not seeing them through Sam's eyes, because she's not in the same room. Yeah. But either way, I think kind of taking all three of these John Hughes movies with a little bit of, it's through the eyes of a teenager that we're probably supposed to be filtering these movies through.
Yeah,
oh, absolutely. I mean, and what do teenagers know?
Oh my God.
Well, if you ask a teenager, teenagers know everything. And then you ask a 20-year-old, and they say, teenagers know jack shit, I know everything. And then you ask a 30-year-old, so on and so forth. So, I actually think, in doing the rewatch, Anthony Michael Hall really is, like, the second, he's almost like a second lead.
Yes.
Oh, sure.
In this movie. Yes. Because he probably has the second most screen time.
Yes.
And second most amount of dialogue, because Jake really, it's kind of quiet.
Yes.
You know, he's a
deep thinker.
Yeah, whereas, you know, they kind of have Farmer Ted being, like, he even says, like, I got this reputation of being, like, this cool ladies' man kind of guy within my group of friends.
He's king of the dipshits.
He's king of the dipshits.
Yeah.
King of the dipshits. And, you know, so he's kind of always probably been the outgoing, outspoken one in his group, like, and doing things like talking to people that he probably, you know, inappropriately and stuff like that. So he has a lot of dialogue throughout this movie, because that's just his character.
But he also is the one that actually helps connect Sam and Jake.
Well, yeah. And
he's the reason that anything with the two of them moves beyond him reading a random survey that she wrote where, I'd bang Jake Ryan if I had the chance.
Oh my God, what a nightmare. When Eric watching that movie, the first time when she drops that note, and he's like, does that lean? And you're like, no!
But again, without those conflicts, then there'd be no movie.
Just not usually how it happens, I don't think. But
I'm wondering, like, I never saw any quiz like that in high school. Maybe that was like an 80s thing or before, or you don't want to admit that you did that quiz.
I don't remember doing anything like that. I remember slam books, but I don't remember.
What's a slam book?
A slam book is actually a lot like that quiz where take like a small notebook, and on the top of each page, you would write that kind of a question. And then the book would get passed around, and obviously by everyone's individual handwriting, you could kind of figure out, like, you know, who's your favorite crush, you know, celebrity crush. And then you'd see a list of different names depending on how many people this book circulated through.
Mm. I'd say the closest that
similar. I mean, it's the closest thing that I ever saw to a survey like this. And I think I did that like in elementary school, maybe once in junior high. I mean,
so they had probably phased out by high school for you.
Yeah. I wasn't doing them I never saw them in high school.
But I was going to say, you ever play MASH?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was probably the closest thing I can think of. At my school, I think that stuff was getting confiscated real fast.
The paper folding?
There's that one, too.
That's different, I thought.
Yeah.
Mm.
That's like the fortune teller thing that looks like a fortune cookie.
Wait, MASH was mansion, apartment, shack, or house,
That
right?
is correct.
Okay, yeah.
We'll play it later.
Okay. I don't remember. We'll probably need to pull up a YouTube.
Jack Pearson on there.
We'll have to put a YouTube video on there or something. And so we'll have so to look up on YouTube.
So it's basically like adolescent fuck, marry, kill.
Yes. Like, and then you pick, like, you get, you know, are you going to have a mansion? Are you going to have a shack? Are you going to have a...
Gotcha. Anyways.
Anyway.
So.
Yes, Farmer Ted set them up. Basically. Yeah,
and he was excited for them because he knew, like, he wasn't going to get anywhere with Sam. He was just really reaching, but she was rejecting him in every way she could, except she showed him some kindness. She showed him some sympathy, and she handed him her underwear.
It only took, you know, and if you think about it.
Like, she helped save his reputation.
If you think about it, he hooked her up with Jake, and all it cost her was her underwear.
I know.
But, you know, he said he only wanted to borrow...
She got him back.
Well, he said he only wanted to borrow him for 10 minutes. And then it's like she just, like, went commando all the way home. Of course, she left right after the dance, so...
Yeah.
Yeah. Long Duck Dong dropped her off. On his way to the party.
He's here for 3 hours, and he finds someone. I'm here my whole life, and I'm still alone. Oh. Poor Samantha Baker.
When you were talking about the scene with them, with Farmer Ted and Sam in the car, that's my favorite scene.
Oh.
When he tells her that he asked about her and she's like, shut up. No, he did not. Like, you're lying. And that feeling, like, you'd have to be lying. Like, you're kidding me. Like, the guy that I'm like, have such a huge crush on is asking about me.
Yeah, how?
No way.
Yeah.
Her reaction was very genuine, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Very genuine.
Yeah. I feel hurt when she's, like, crying in the hall. Yeah.
And then how she does all the rehearsal. Like, she's rehearsing in the hallway.
Yeah.
All the things that she wants to say. And then when she finally gets in front of him, she completely clams up and turns around and runs away because she's so nervous.
Yep. I understand.
Very embarrassing.
Mm-hmm. Who's your favorite character?
It's Anthony Michael Hall. Yeah.
Farmer
it's
Ted.
The geek.
Farmer Ted.
Yeah.
Kind of want to call him that. To me, he's Farmer Ted.
He's Farmer Ted. Yeah. I know. I've always liked him. I've always, when I was younger, I thought he was super cute. Such a huge dork.
With his braces.
Yeah, he's cute.
He's got incredible comedic timing.
He does.
So
I think
funny.
He's very funny. But he's my favorite. I mean, I like other characters, too. I do really like Jake, too, but...
I'm not sure how old he was when he played that role, but he actually kind of... He didn't look like a freshman, but he looked like he was in high school.
Oh, yeah.
To me, and, you know, and really kind of pulled it off.
All right.
All right. Very hot. Very hot.
And then John Cusack is also very cute in that movie. He looks like a little baby. He's just so...
He is.
So young.
Our buddy John.
I know.
Mm-hmm.
So, Nancy, and your favorite character, see?
I think it's Anthony Michael Hall also. He's just... I feel he's the glue in this story. I mean, he's a fly in the ointment at the beginning of the movie when she gets on the bus and, oh my God, who is this nerd sitting next to me? Why won't he leave me alone? I mean, they play that...
Dragnet music
when he's approaching her, and it's just like, oh God, what's gonna happen? But I mean, he's great. He's so funny. I mean, and even this, I mean, so many scenes with him, like when Jake rescues him when he's trapped under the glass table from the party.
That's so funny.
When he's making the martinis with Jake, mm-hmm. and then
their relationship is so cute too.
I love Jake and Farmer Ted together. Yeah. They are hilarious because Jake is very chill. He's just so, it's all right. I trust you to get her home. You're not going to leave her in some parking lot.
He's a good guy.
You're good. You're fine. Mm-hmm. I mean, he recognizes that Farmer Ted is not trying to jerk him around or abuse him or just take advantage of him.
Because he'd kill him.
Yeah.
I mean, he's definitely much bigger than him and probably, you know, in real life, 30 years older than him.
You know what? And talking about them together, maybe my favorite scene is when the party has, like, kind of dissipated and they're in the kitchen and they're talking about, what are you going to do with her? Because honestly, if all you want to do is mess around with her, I'm going to get a bunch of guys to kick your ass. Like, the fact that he was able to kind of feel that Farmer Ted was able to feel such loyalty to Sam and want to be protective of her really made Jake see, like, wait a second. This really could be a girl that's really special that I should be good to. And I thought it was great. Yours, Matt? Your favorite character and favorite scene?
Well, not to you know, hop on the bandwagon, but yeah, Farmer Ted. I think
he's great.
I think he's probably my favorite, if not the best character in it. It's a close race, though. I really enjoy watching Long Duck Dong in this movie.
He's super funny.
He's hilarious.
that actor, he does a great job, and he's a really good actor. He's not, you know, Mr. Superstar, but he was on ER for a really long time.
Mm. Yes.
I really liked him in that. But yeah, Anthony Michael Hall really nails it in this movie.
Yep.
And
he's so young.
Yeah, he's very young, but he's... you know, he's kind of, you know, precocious and, you know, probably does things that, you know, are immature and whatnot. But in the end, he ends up being, like, an actual real person that, you know, once he's away from his group,
mm-hmm.
you know, I will say this. I think it goes to mention, and we had kind of, Sherry had kind of hinted at it about the idea of consent.
Oh, God, yeah.
You know, the whole idea of him taking Jake's, or Caroline, Jake's girlfriend, home, and Jake's whole, like, do whatever you want with her kind of aspect of it is very wrong.
Yeah.
and like, watching this as a kid, you don't really clue in on this.
No, it wasn't until I watched it a while recently that I was like,
as I was a little older, I'm like, yeah. Wow. This is not really great, but I think at the same time...
I don't think anything happened with him.
Nothing happened.
I think they both remember it wrong, too. I agree.
I think nothing happened.
But they're cute, too.
Nothing happened. Farmer Ted, Nick, parks the car, passes out. I mean, he has the, like, when he wakes up in the next morning in the parking lot, he has his headgear on.
Which...
So, he obviously so was funny. Like, it's almost like, you know, I'm not going to do anything. He probably put a blanket on her... And then put his headgear on. They passed out in the car. I mean,
was he carrying his headgear around like in his backpack?
I know.
Probably. Where does that come from?
Like, what the hell?
I mean, he was being a very responsible young man. But I'm sure nothing happened there. And you know, he never would have done anything. I mean, look at how hard it was for him to get her underwear, and the fact that he did it. I mean, but that's probably as far as he would go.
Yeah.
The real person that's at fault in that whole situation is Jake. So now I'm kind of worried. Now, at the end of this movie, I'm like, you know, Sam, is Jake really, really the guy?
You know what?
But I think he was so pissed at her.
Yeah.
For ruining his house.
Yep.
Ruining his parents' house.
Well, yeah, she...
Destroying
the
wine cellar, all this stuff.
Take out all
he
that
was
in
probably,
it.
He was probably like, I don't give an F about
right.
this girl.
Right. But that was like
she
his
doesn't
buddy.
Give
He'd
an
feel the
F
same.
About me.
Right, I'm going right. to also... suggest that wasn't the first time she invited tons of people from high school.
She said it wasn't.
She says, you know, I invited a bunch of people over, but Jake hates it when I invite people to his house because they always trash his parents' house.
Yeah, so he's dealt with that before, and he's just over it. But so. I know I already said that their conversation was my favorite scene, but I mean, of course, close runner-up is the very last scene.
Sure.
When at the church where the last car pulls away, she sees him standing there, and then they end, for whatever reason, sitting on top of a cot, on top of a dining table over a birthday cake, you know.
And she walks out and she points to herself
with
me?
With the Thompson Twins song playing in the background.
It was probably,
sweet.
It was probably like one of those, you know, John Hughes had like a vision in his head of
right.
how he wanted the shot to mm-hmm. be, and he was just going to do
it. Perfect.
As ridiculous
it
as it might seem, like, why are they doing this? But
so much of the movie was.
I mean, so, I mean, I think that my favorite scene, I really like the scene in the shop, in the school shop between mm-hmm. Farmer Ted and Sam, and I think that's, and I like the scene in the kitchen, in Jake's kitchen. I think my other
exercise bike.
Yeah, the just exercise bike. Absolutely. Her lifting the weights, or just pretending I'm Long Duck Dong dancing with her. No, no.
I'm kidding.
Not that that would have been bad, but just from like an absurdity kind of comedic point of view, I think that a very kind of interesting scene that sticks in my head is, without Sam or Farmer Ted, is the dinner that her parents go to meet the in-laws.
The very Godfather feeling.
It even has the Godfather music behind it and everything like that.
So weird.
It's so such a bizarre scene, but I like think so of that bizarre. Scene yeah. and it's just
I forgot it's about
uncomfortable.
It.
Uncomfortable. That
it's
scene.
Well, but it's supposed to because it's so awkward.
Yeah.
I just always kind of remember that scene for some reason. And I think that scene has been mocked and like or redone in so many ways, probably in real life.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting.
One of my favorite lines is, "If it's okay with my dad, she's coming home with me."
Farmer Ted.
I just had to.
I mean, I think the consensus holds strong. Former Ted.
Yep, he's the best.
I mean, and we also. I mean, I also think that it's appropriate to give a clear shout out to Molly Ringwald.
Of course.
Oh, she's amazing. I mean,
this
movie doesn't exist without her.
No,
and she's wonderful with playing that. I mean, she fully epitomizes what a pissed off 16-year-old on their 16th birthday. Whose parents completely forget it and. I mean, I can't believe she wasn't more, like, screaming mad in their faces when they both finally realized it. Like, she was just so, I was mad earlier, but I'm over it now. It's like, you're not over it. Like, what? I mean.
I think she was just, like, so tired and, like, so many other things had happened to her with Jake and everything like that it almost seemed secondary. But, I mean, you know. John Hughes really kind of nails her, you know, all the situations, like. And while we're rewatching it, it's like, how does her mom not?
That's the one I have to say as a mom.
And then
like, but
grandma.
Grandparents. Grandparents live for this shit.
Right? No, I agree. It's, you know.
Yeah.
So all of that together, I mean, it's
very
pretty
silly,
spot on.
But it's hilarious.
Yeah.
It's a fun idea. And I really enjoy movies that happen in a short period of time. Like this one where it's like, you know, it's a weekend.
It's 2 days.
You know.
Yeah.
So
yeah, it's very
It's cool.
All right, so we're gonna move on to our next movie, and I'm gonna talk about The Breakfast Club. But before I do that, I want to correct myself. At the opening of the episode, I neglected one of the John Hughes high school teen comedies, Pretty in Pink, which I neglected because we talked about it once already, but. We have to make sure that we include that. So, 16 Candles, Breakfast Club. I'm trying to do it in chronological order as of release. Then Weird Science. Then Pretty in Pink. Then Ferris Bueller. Then Some Kind of Wonderful. So, and...
good job, Matt.
You know, I lived through
your life
it.
For all of them.
But, I mean, and we'll talk about this at the end. Where, you know, John Hughes put out, you know, he was involved with a lot of movies that we grew up with, a lot of great comedies, and some things that we, you know, you have to really look at and go, oh, yeah, he did write National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
He did.
He did write Mr. Mom.
Right, you know,
Vacation.
So, anyway, moving on, The Breakfast Club, probably... one of those like big iconic movies from the 80s. If you were a teenager, you know, watching this movie, and then I think the first time I had seen it, I'd probably just seen it on TBS.
Me too.
So I'd always kind of seen it edited, and then as I got older, I watched the whole movie, you know, unedited and everything, and got the jokes more as I got older and whatnot. I've always really enjoyed this movie. It has comedy, it has drama, it has...
it's probably the most serious of the high school movies he ever did.
It's pretty serious. I mean, I think all of them have certain elements of like a serious factor. Like we talked about in Pretty in Pink, there's the class war mm-hmm. kind of aspect of it mm-hmm. and the struggles Molly Ringwald's character has living with her dad because mm-hmm. her mom had left and all that. But in this movie, you have five kids, all from different kind of cliquey areas mm-hmm. of their school, all having detention together and kind of getting to know each other. And in the, you know, as it's going on, it's almost kind of like hostile in some ways and, you know, not really kind of not really comfortable, not really wanting to know, get to know them. They just want to kind of do their time for the day.
Yeah.
And, they all have kind of a common enemy in the vice principal or dean of students or whatever you want to call him, who is, you know, managing the detention. By the end of this movie, they all kind of grow together and like discover things about kid, you know, each other. And, you know, they tell their stories about how they got, you know, got detention, and some of them are like, oh, I skipped school to go shopping, and others are, you know, I had a gun in my locker because I thought about committing suicide. And,
yeah.
you know, it goes, it's rough in some of those scenes, but you've got, I think that one of the things that I've always loved about the movie has always changed for me. When I first was watching the movie, I think I always kind of liked, like, it had cool music, mm-hmm. and it was like, oh, I'm young, and I'm watching these kids in high school, and mm-hmm. it was like, oh, I wonder if this is what high school will be like, oh, and yeah. stuff like that.
Yeah.
Then, as when I was, like, a teenager watching this, I think I kind of gravitated towards certain characters in different ways, because I was the same age, and I could relate to this aspect of this character, and this aspect of this other character. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, it was John Bender is funny, mm-hmm. and he had very kind of iconic dialogue, played by Judd Nelson, and it was very he was very edgy, so mm-hmm. it was kind of easy to kind of be like, oh wow, this guy's cool to watch.
Yeah.
And then as I got older, you know, I kind of, you know, I had grown out of that, you know, that age group. And watch it again, I can kind of look at it from a different perspective and see different characters that I relate to in different ways.
You like the vice principal now. Is that what you're
trying to tell me? No, I like Carl.
Carl.
Carl the janitor. Carl, who is also the groom yeah. in 16 Candles.
He is the eyes and ears of that institution.
No. Yeah. Yeah. This movie's meant a lot to a lot of different people for all these different reasons. But I think, you know, for me, watching this movie like today, I just kind of see it from like the person's point of view of I lived it and I got out of it, and now I'm looking at like that generation and kind of like a wow, they, as tough as things seem in high school, don't you're gonna get through it kind of eyes. And, you know, everyone's situation in high school is different. And we had talked about this on previous episodes where, you know, you kind of don't necessarily really know everyone that you go to high school with and what their background story is.
Yeah.
Like, impossible. I mean, unless you live in a very small town, you really don't know like the real life goings on until you actually like start to talk to them and get to know them. And
this is one of the first times when I watched this movie that I really clicked when I was younger about how much a parent's situation can affect their children. Like that kids are really, that they're affected. They're not just live in a vacuum. Like they really are, how much they're affected by how their parents are, you know?
Well, there's that. Yeah. There's that.
When I was young.
There's that aspect of it. But just the idea that like, you know, when you're in high school, you're probably really focused on number one, yourself, a lot of the times. And then you have your like close immediate friends, like these kids do. They mm-hmm. have their little groups and everything. And it's not until they got put into this situation that they really, they felt safe because it was only the five of them. Like they could open up and maybe the five of them, they could trust them enough to where like they're not going to tell like their secrets to the other kids that they know. But they did it anyway.
Yeah.
But once they got to know their situation, like, they really kind of, like, were like, wow.
They had empathy.
I'm the princess, and, you know, you're the kid with no friends, but, wow, we both have shitty parents because they ignore you and mm-hmm. everything. So we can be friends. We have something in common. Yeah. And I would like to think that, like, kids could watch this movie with a larger, like, perspective. And I think a lot of kids these days have that and really kind of understand, like, until you really get to know somebody, don't judge them or treat them a certain way. And, you know,
I will say though, I'm going to talk about this more later in the episode about how I feel there's kind of a fantasy element about all three of these movies, but the fantasy element in Breakfast Club nowadays is unless on a Saturday detention, everybody's cell phones were to be confiscated from them. There's no way this movie would ever make sense nowadays. I mean,
to be confiscated.
It makes sense in the 80s because there was no internet. There was nothing that they could do to occupy themselves but socialize with each other.
Did you guys ever have detention?
I did.
I may have. I don't remember.
I had in-house suspension for fighting, so
it was a crazy day. I remember that. Day.
And anyway, I basically I was in a room, and it was almost like Breakfast Club, but the teacher was there, and I wasn't supposed to speak, and I had to like do homework.
I wasn't sure if either of you ever had it, so I have. I had Saturday detention once, which I can't even remember why, but I had it.
I know for a fact that, and I'm not really being serious, that you cell phones don't really work that well if you have Saturday detention and you're in Jumanji Welcome to the Jungle. Because in that, you might accidentally be cleaning an old classroom and then get sucked into a video game. And your cell phone won't work.
I haven't seen that movie.
I highly recommend it.
Is that the one with The Rock?
It's not bad.
And Kevin Hart. It's not bad. It's entertaining. Hey, it did well enough. They're making another one that comes out soon.
of the John Hughes movies, I think this is the one Matt and I watched the most.
Absolutely.
I think he and I can recite a lot of the dialogue. We're not going to right now. But there's plenty of times where we could almost reenact full scenes.
I've seen Ferris Bueller a lot, but I think I've seen Breakfast Club more times.
Hey, Sherry, do you belong to the physics club?
It's an academic club.
Okay. So I've always kind of felt, and to your point, like when we intro'd this, this is really kind of, I always see this as kind of a serious movie. Mm-hmm. It's got it obviously we laugh at Bender. We laugh at some of the funny things that happen. Some of
some stuff hasn't aged well.
Yeah, some stuff has not aged well.
There's definitely bullying within the movie. I mean, you know, Andy is in suspension for assaulting a kid and effectively bullying him.
Yeah.
Bender is bullying all of them throughout the course of this day.
He just has perpetual Saturday detention.
I mean, and then he's being bullied by the principal when he gets isolated. And, I mean, it's... There's some hard stuff in this movie.
Oh yeah.
I think that depending on how much we believe Ally Sheedy's character, she either, like she says, is there because she had nothing better to do and just showed up there, or she also has a lot of stuff in her bag and stole someone's wallet.
That's what I think.
So
it
she
is.
Probably stole something, and that's why she's in there. Although.
She's a compulsive liar, too.
Modern times, if you stole something, you would not be in Saturday detention. You'd probably be in jail or suspended.
Yeah, I think she probably stole something, and that's why she was there.
So, you're right. They all have done something bad to get there. It's not like, you know, and even Andy's, he would not get Saturday detention for that.
He'd be in jail.
He'd probably, or get suspended for assaulting a kid. But, but then again... He was like one of the best guys on the wrestling team, so maybe he got special treatment. We don't know. Back then,
it's very believable.
That's believable.
That was what his punishment was. Oh yeah.
I will also point out, and this movie has some diversity issues, but
yes.
But I don't know if this suburb, you know, which suburb of Chicago this is, but. You know, it could be one that is not very diverse.
Wasn't it Sherman or Shermer or something? Because that was the name of the high school.
I guess.
Yeah.
It could be fictional, too.
It probably is.
This
Most of John Hughes movies take place in like the Chicago, greater Chicago area.
Yes. So, that's one of the reasons why, I forget which movie it was. One of his movies, and it might have been Some Kind of Wonderful, that he actually didn't direct it. He only has a writing credit on it because I think they wanted to film it near LA, and he wouldn't. He's like, I'm not.
Right. I think it was because I think Howard Deutsch was the director on Some Kind of Wonderful.
So
I have to look it up.
But anyway, just moving on. We're gonna play a little game when we're done here. But my favorite character in this movie, what?
Oh, I thought we were gonna rank them least favorite and end on our favorite.
Oh,
and we were each gonna go through and do that.
Oh no, I thought we were gonna play which character do you relate to the most.
I have that question here.
Oh, okay. Why don't we play that first and then we'll do the ranking?
Okay,
because doesn't have to be the same.
No, because just because you like a character doesn't mean you relate to them.
Exactly.
I would say that if I was going to say I relate, like, related to now or related to in high school, I think that, like, if I was relating to in high school, minus the pressure I felt from my parents for grades, it was probably Brian, Anthony Michael Hall's character. What we were doing in school is probably that. I mean, I think I might have had a little bit of Ally Sheedy sometimes.
Yeah, me too. Because I was a little bit.
But
weird.
I was never Andy the jock, and I was never prom queen status. And I probably had smart mouthy, you know, bender qualities sometimes, but the one I most probably relate to is Anthony Michael Hall.
Yeah. I know when I used to watch it as a kid, like that was like when I first watched it and he's explaining how he feels and what he does and stuff. I'm like, oh
yeah.
Like I get this.
Yeah. Well, I mean, when he's talking about pressure, because when they're having the confrontation in the last act of the movie and, you know, Claire is saying, you don't understand the kind of pressure that Andy and I have trying to be popular.
Because of status.
Yeah, she's like, you don't think I understand pressure? I mean, because he's like, I can't come home with a B.
Yep.
I need to have all A's.
I understand.
Yeah.
One thing I'd like to note, the dad that picks him up, I believe, is John Hughes in the car. Picks him up at the end of the movie.
Yes.
John Hughes is the guy driving the car.
So why are you putting so much pressure on Brian, John Hughes?
Exactly. Be nice to your kid.
You know what he just went through? He tried to shoot himself with a flare gun.
Yeah.
So your favorite character, or the one you relate to the most, Brian.
Yes.
Brian.
Yeah.
All right. We're all Brians.
All right,
so we're all writing our papers right now.
Exactly, and that would be me too. I'd end up doing all the work for all. Like you should do.
Oh
it,
yeah,
Sherry.
I think all three of us have ended up in the unfortunate group project setup where we end up doing a majority of the work and being very irritated and bitter about it.
Maybe not you as much. And probably more Nancy and I.
I kind of always kind of felt like I floated by in high school and then like once high school is over, like gigantic brain dump and I forgot everything.
Then you're not Brian.
Well, Matt's saying brain dump of the experience.
No, brain dump of the knowledge.
Oh, okay.
So if I'm, I'll start it off. So if I'm ranking characters, like least favorite, are we only talking about the five kids?
Yes.
We don't care about
the janitor. We certainly would not like the
least
principal.
Favorite to most favorite.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
From an entertainment factor or how much I like
just
them.
Just your personal opinion.
Oh, like if I'm doing this on a whim, my least favorite, Andy.
Same.
Same.
Then Claire.
Same.
Not me.
Then, no.
I'll tell you mine later.
Then probably Brian, Ally Sheedy's character, whose name I can't remember.
Allison.
Then Bender. Like I know he has all the iconic lines. Even though he's such a jerk, he's the one that you like. He's the one you're really watching in the movie.
Oh yeah. He moves the story along.
He really kind of moves the story along. And in the end, he's also, as much as he he tries to be very real, you know, when
it's also being physically abused.
Yeah. I mean,
I don't know if any of them are,
you know, he might get off on like giving Brian shit for, you know, his Mr. Rogers lifestyle that he thinks he has. But again, at the end of the movie, like as they're sitting there talking, he's really kind of listening.
Oh yeah.
With the exception of when he's giving Claire shit, you know, but ultimately he was giving Claire shit because he really liked her.
I don't like that.
No, it's wrong. I mean,
you do your ranking, Sherry.
It's Andrew, then Claire, Allison, Brian, then Bender.
So my ranking is almost the same as yours. Mine is Andrew, Allison,
okay,
Claire in the middle.
Yeah.
But then it is a neck and neck race, and I think depending on the day, Brian is my favorite.
Brian and Bender. Me too.
It alternates between Brian and Bender as my favorite.
Whether you're the one with the weed or the one holding the weed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
So. No.
And that wasn't really hard for me to think of because, you know, Allison has very little to do in this movie. She's just she doesn't even speak until almost halfway through the movie, if not further in. I mean, the most noise she makes is when she's cracking the Captain Crunch cereal in her very weird sandwich with, like, the sugar sticks.
And Pixie Sticks, oh yeah.
It's Pixie Sticks, Captain Crunch on bread.
It's so weird.
Who gave her that pimento look?
She's the symbolism of weird goth kid. The closest you're going to get in that movie. So
bizarre.
Which is great.
And she just seemed like...
I can totally see why she annoys you.
She annoys me for a lot of reasons. Like, you know, like when she dumps her whole purse... Like when she asked the guys after they got high, you guys want to see what's in my bag? And they're like, no. And she's just like, whatever.
Yeah, but her whole thing though is that, like, she's in the shadows, like no one knows her, trying to open up, and you know her parents ignore her. You know she just feels like she's nothing, and so she's there, whether she's there willingly or not. You know she's like, okay, I'm gonna try and connect with these people, and then and then Claire at the end, you know helps her kind of, you know. Gives her a little makeup and dolls her up a little bit, and she gets to really have a real connection with Andy. And I think that this is probably one of my favorite Emilio Estevez roles, just because
he's still my least favorite.
Even though he's my least favorite, Mighty Ducks. Oh,
he's nicer in that movie than he is in this movie.
He is. That's so cheap.
Billy the Kid, Young Guns, and Young Guns 2. Thank you.
Yeah. Pretty cool, and you can't really get wrong about that one. But
obsessed medical.
He's very good in this movie, though.
St. Elmo's Fire, like I'm in that.
I still need to watch that.
You will.
But I liked Allison, and I think that so that's why I rank her third. But
Sherry understands why she's my second to the last.
I knew she would be lower for you. I knew.
She's like between two and three sometimes for me. Because I just think it's funny, too.
I love her because she's fucking weird.
Dancing.
Right?
Her and Bender.
Oh, talking about dancing, though. Like, Molly Ringwald doing, like,
the
total 80s goofball dance with,
iconic.
You know, The knees, the feet, the kicking,
Nancy's doing it right now.
Doing it right now, you know, the elbows. It's like the elbows are very important in this dance, and the twisting. It's very silly.
Yeah, there's a couple of, like, music video moments in this movie, like with little montages and stuff, like them running through the halls and all that.
Yeah, the
nightmares for librarians.
Sliding through the halls.
Okay. Do they think the principal is deaf? Because how did the principal not hear?
Well, he was gone for a while.
Crazy ass footsteps as they're running all through the halls. Like, you can't tell me that he wouldn't have heard the.
Yeah, it's definitely questionable.
It's very silly.
There's lots of silly things. In this movie.
All of these movies have a lot of elements of fantasy.
They're trying to have a scholarship.
The main door that they closed was a was a double door. When Bender took the screw out of one door, why didn't they just open the other door?
One of Sherry's favorite quotes ever is "Screws fall out all the time. The world's an imperfect place."
Yeah,
I say it all the time. I love that line.
Can you describe the ruckus?
I think your dad and my dad should get together and go bowling.
Yeah.
Bender has the best lines.
Bender is great. I mean, I think growing up and seeing someone so irreverent and so mouthy, you know, just so just angry and just so willing to stand up to authority was very interesting for me and Matt.
Oh, just yeah. that whole scene when
he gets 10 more detentions.
When he gets all the detentions. Actually, do you want another one? Yes.
Then that's Brian right there.
You got another one.
I've got you for your whole natural born life. Yeah.
And he tells him when he starts counting. That's one of my favorites when Brian is like, well, actually, it was, what does he say, 7. And when you came in and you told him that he, what did he raid Barry Manilow's wardrobe?
Now it's 8. You shut up.
No, it's 7. It's really 7. Yeah.
This movie still holds up, too. Right? Teenagers still watch it. People love
teenagers
it.
Teenagers should watch it.
They should.
Like Matt said earlier, minus the, like, diversity issues that are a problem in this movie, that aside, I still think the bigger issues of, you know, the different kinds of abuse that the kids have with, you know, the different levels. I mean, and you've got, like, Allison in particular. She's completely neglected. That's one way that she's abused. And then you have Andy's parents just
to Brian.
Them to overachievers in what they're good at, but also to a level of almost psychosis. And then Claire's dad, like her parents use her as like a pawn and to fight between them. And then of course Bender's dad is just beats him and gives him cigarettes for Christmas.
I think also, you know, you bring up an extra interesting point, you know, Allison's parents neglect her. And in a way, even though Claire is being spoiled, they're kind of neglecting her too, because while they're paying attention to her, it's more just it's material, but it's only to use them to fight amongst each other.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not really, I mean, how much are they really caring about her? So.
There's no connection. There's no like emotional support. It's just like, here's your diamond earrings for Christmas.
Right.
So what's your favorite scenes?
You go first.
My favorite scene is when he's crawling through the ceiling and he's telling that joke, which I at one point even Googled to see if there was a punchline to the joke. There's not. But, yeah. And he falls and he screams. Yep. Oh, and then he's like, I forgot my pencil. it's like hot for teacher.
That's another. I walk into a room. Got my pencil. Well, the iconic, you know, scene of them kind of sitting in the round and having their kind of really opening up, I think we can all agree is probably one of the best scenes in the movie.
Towards the end.
I think one of my favorite scenes, even though it's not a really fun scene to watch, is when Bender does first the impression of Brian's family and then does the impression of his own family.
Yeah.
Is that for real? You want to come over sometime? I mean, that whole kind of thing is
did I stutter?
Yeah. I remember being able to, like, I don't think I can do it now, but I used to be able to recite both of those.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that, Dad. The other kids are like, don't, they're like, he's lying. And it's like, yeah, no, he's not.
Yeah. I mean, he has friends, but I mean, I think that a lot of times, like, and I think I had some friends like this. I had like close friends, and then I had friends that I hung out with because it was like fun to do stuff with.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't remember really opening up to those friends.
You're more just hangout friends?
Yeah, like people I would go and do stuff with, but I didn't open up to them as much as I did other friends. And, I think that, you know, Bender might have had, like, you know, the guys he went and got high with or did whatever with.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, maybe these four other people in detention are the only ones that, you know, because he was forced to be there, first ones that actually, like, listened to this shit that he was going through. Yeah. And maybe that's why he ends up having a kind of a connection to Claire at the end.
Yeah. I think my favorite scene is part of that discussion towards the very end where Brian asks, so what happens on Monday? And she goes, yeah. Oh, you mean when we're all back in school, are we going to act like we like each other? And then them having to kind of dig deep and really understand that because of the cliques that they're in, how easy would it be for them to keep a connection? And, you know, Brian really being very honest about how screwed up that is. And Claire also being really honest and saying, this, I don't know what else to do.
Yeah.
You know, I'm sorry. I know it sucks. I hate that it's like this. And this is why I like her more than Andy. Because I think Andy was lying a bit about how easy he thinks it would have been to just be like, oh, sure, Brian, how's it going? But then
I think
Claire was a lot more, Claire's a lot more tuned in to just how screwed up this the clique situation is. She says she hates it. She doesn't like being caught up in it, but she doesn't know how to get out of it.
Well, I think here's where I'll disagree with you a little bit.
It's okay.
Is Andy, because of, you know, he's on the wrestling team, he's fit and everything like that, and he was probably kind of like one of the leaders in his group. If Brian was up, you know, walks by him, is like, hey, Andy, and he goes, hey, what's up, man? And all the other guys are like, why are you talking to that guy? He'd be like, hey, I had detention with that guy. He's a good guy, or I'll beat the shit out of you. He could actually do that. I don't know if Claire has that position to do with her friends.
Andy would not do that.
Andy would not do that.
I don't know.
Remember?
He sucks.
Allison said he does what everybody, he doesn't think for himself. That but is his big problem.
But he just he had agrees. This whole opening moment, and he hooked up with Allison.
Well, maybe after the end of it, but at that but point, when they, were that, when they were saying that, he wouldn't have.
It's
yet.
Because she didn't have all that black shit on her eyes anymore.
But my point
which I take offense to.
I know.
Yeah,
but honestly, I mean, maybe if you're going to watch this movie and think that, hey, maybe this detention actually changed these people so they at least can connect with each other if they don't want to connect with the system, you know, or school or whatever, they can still connect with each other. You know, I think that everything about this for Andy was kind of eye-opening in a sense that, like, he knew he fucked up. And he knew that he did this for the wrong reasons.
Yeah,
and,
well, hopefully he learned.
You know, and maybe he actually learned something from this.
I don't know if you guys have had that personal experience of what exactly Brian is talking about in the movie, but I have, like, where you know, you're stuck in a smaller group of people that you don't usually hang out with in high school, and then when you're back, like, in high school, it's kind of like, maybe it happened a little bit, but they don't, where they don't really, like, you know, it's not like it was kind of a thing.
Yeah,
so,
well, and I
understand what he's talking about.
I mean, I'm not sure, and I'm not saying that that doesn't happen.
Oh, no, I know you're not. I know.
I don't say that it doesn't happen, but to me, though, it emphasizes even more, like, Claire's kind of shitty. Like, yes, I applaud her for recognizing that it probably would not be good. But at the same time, I also think that she needs to take more ownership of herself and not just fall into the trap of the cliques that she's in.
And I will say, not to just be like a Claire defender by any means, but she does take good. Ownership of it because she reaches out to connect with Bender at the end. And like he says, why did you do that? And she goes, because I knew you wouldn't. So she wouldn't have walked out of the school kind of hand in hand with him at the end of detention, hooking up with him or whatever, and giving him one of her diamond earrings if she wasn't willing to be able to, like, show the world, because she makes such a big deal throughout the whole movie about, I believe in one guy, one girl. I don't believe in playing the field or anything like that. That's why she hadn't had sex yet and all that. Ooh, Matt is pointing an angry finger at me. He wants to say something.
He has an excited finger.
All of that is very true. Totally agree with you, with one exception. Bender says, after she kisses him and says, why did you do that? I didn't think, you know, because I knew you wouldn't. You know how your mom and dad always, you know, pin you, you know, each other against whatever? Wouldn't I be great at that capacity? In some ways, maybe she doesn't tell her friends that she's hooking up with Bender, but does tell her parents to piss off her parents. Maybe get her parents together.
I think that they're together in the next week in school.
I don't know.
Who knows how long it lasts?
Hughes didn't do Breakfast Club, the sequel. So
which is what's great about these movies is they don't have sequels, which, you know, nowadays it'd be like, They'd make sequels.
And then he made more Home Alone.
American Pie 4. Hey, Home Alone, leave Home Alone
and,
alone.
And you know what's funny is, and we're kind of going off topic, but like, even though there were multiple vacation movies with like Vacation, European Vacation, and Christmas Vacation, because they have different kids, I kind of feel like they're not sequels. They're just standalone movies.
No, they are. I mean,
they are.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Anthony Vegas Michael Hall is
Anthony Michael is Hall. That one of them? Rusty. Yep. Rusty number one.
I know. Yeah.
And then
that's the one with the dead grandma. On the
vacation.
On the,
yeah. Vacation's
yeah.
great.
Yeah.
Maybe you guys will have to do a National Lampoon's
Vacation. The one we watched the most was European Vacation.
European Vacation.
That's
great.
When I learned about turnabouts. That's the movie that taught me about.
I cannot get left.
Matt and Sherry have turnabouts in their area, and it always cracks me up.
No, we have crossing circles. They're different.
Traffic
circles.
If you ask
traffic
my
circles,
we had to look them up. We had to look them
traffic
up.
Traffic circles have stop
day.
Signs.
That's why we know.
Roundabouts don't have stop signs, and it's just a yield.
Oh,
that's
boy.
The difference.
Okay. If you ask my Australian Siri, he'll tell you at the third exit on the roundabout. That's what he tells me. So he's calling them a roundabout.
Either All way. Right. So I think that unless anyone has anything else that they'd like to add about this amazing movie.
I think it really holds up.
It holds up.
I hadn't seen it in a long time because, like we established on our last episode, I don't really rewatch a lot of movies in the last 10 years because I'm just too busy. But this movie really holds up, and I was thrilled to rewatch it.
I know whenever, if it comes on TV, or I've put it on a few times because I feel like watching it, but it always has that Saturday comfort feeling for me, like when it used to be like on TBS or whatever, and I had to watch it.
It's like if we watch it on a Saturday, it's like we're in detention with
it's just got that.
The only other thing that I'd add is, A, I'd really hope they never remake it, but B, if they ever did remake it, more diversity, and I think it would be hilarious if Judd Nelson played Bender and was the principal.
That would be good.
That would be funny.
That's kind of like how Matthew Broderick eventually played a principal in Election. Even though he's been
a jerky,
pain-in-the-ass high school student in both War Games and Ferris Bueller.
All right. So, Sherry, do you want to, you know, you haven't done this before, but do you want to give us a little kind of intro to our last movie?
All right. So, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, done in 1986, again by John Hughes, written and directed, starring Matthew Broderick as Ferris, Alan Ruck as Cameron, Mia Sara as Sloane. Fun fact, Molly Ringwald wanted to play Sloane, but John Hughes told her that the role was beneath her.
Oh, okay.
John Hughes wrote this movie in, I believe, 6 days.
Hmm.
And I think Mia Sara is probably the youngest actress, but they're still all in there. Maybe she was 18.
She was
maybe.
18
yeah.
playing a 17-year-old.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So she was the closest, but I think that Matthew Broderick was like 23, and Alan Ruck is like 29 in this movie.
Yeah. I mean, we've talked about this on previous episodes before, but man.
I don't care how old he is because he's amazing.
Alan Ruck, I think that breaks the record from the chick from 90210, because I think she was like 28.
Andrea?
Stockard Channing in Greece will break all those records. Playing Rizzo.
Yeah. I give that a pass because it's a musical.
Jack said the same thing.
See?
only because I think as you're...
Always like that, Jack.
He's the best. I think he said the same thing because, you have to get... Anyway, the musical talent needed has to be a little more established. Although Olivia Newton-John may have even been older than Stockard Channing. I'd have to
probably. Yeah. But my to that point...
No, Alan Ruck is a lot older.
I mean, I think there's scenes where Cameron, like, his hair moves and there's gray in it. I mean...
So, this movie, I'll just sum up the main idea of the plot in the beginning is it's too nice outside. Ferris does not want to go to school and he's going to take his ninth sick day that semester.
Nine times.
Yeah. And he's got to fake his way through that sick day so that his parents and especially Principal Rooney. So he doesn't find out. Shout out to Mrs. Poole as, you know, Ed's secretary.
Who is also in Carrie.
Yes, she is.
She's one of the girls that
made
fun of Carrie.
She was.
Yeah, she was. Yep. Yep.
She was a little little younger there.
She's not a righteous dude in that movie. No. Or in this one.
No. One quick little thing about her character was when they couldn't get her hair right, so she did her hair herself. When John Hughes saw it, he says to her, "Wow, I wonder how many pencils you could fit in there." And that's how the whole scene of her pulling the pencils out came up, like, right on the fly.
I will say I like that she's got kind of, like, a Minnesota accent. Or, like, a...
Yes.
I think
it's supposed to be more Chicago.
Yeah. No, but, I mean, I believe that she's from kind of, that region, like, what you hear, like, in Fargo or whatnot. Yeah. Just that
I feel like more... the Hogan family, they were in Minnesota. I don't remember.
No idea.
Anyway, but this movie... While I might love Breakfast Club just a little bit more, I saw Ferris Bueller. I realized it's the first John Hughes movie that I saw.
Oh, okay.
And my dad had me watch it. I've loved it ever since. It still makes me laugh.
How many times did you cut school?
Never. I didn't. I was Brian. I know. Cut school. Not like my mom.
Okay, so...
My mom would get dropped off sometimes at the front of high school, and my grandpa went around the back once, and she was walking out the back. She's... Not me, though. Her daughter, that would not happen, but... it was like senior cut day, so we were all gone. I mean, that doesn't count.
That's okay. You're allowed.
Yeah. This movie is just so funny. The way that Ferris fucks with people, I mean, it's just classic. I wish I was that kind of prankster. I wish I was that inventive, but...
Did you already mention that Jennifer Grey plays his sister?
No, I didn't say Jennifer Grey yet. Yeah, okay. Jeannie's great. Love Jennifer Grey.
I think the sibling... So, back to our 16 Candles discussion and sibling rivalries, I mean, I don't know if there's... another John Hughes movie that has quite the sibling rivalry that this movie has.
From that time, I'd say no. Macaulay Culkin really hates his family in Home Alone.
But he's like 6 or 7,
but
right?
Most of the movie is him by himself. I can't remember.
Yeah. Are Ferris and Janie supposed to be twins?
No.
She's younger then? Because he's supposed to be graduating. What year is she? Because she already has a car. Because he got a computer.
I thought she was older.
Then why is she... No. Well, then they may have been twins.
Maybe they're twins. Yeah, maybe you're right. Mm. Rocky Raccoon is outside.
Sounds like a frog.
So I just need to throw out here. I didn't really enjoy this movie as a kid.
Okay.
And I'll tell you, a lot of it was... how I could not understand the timeline in this movie.
Okay.
So, there is no...
You're not the only one online that has a problem with the timeline.
Well, I'll tell you, though.
That is definitely a problem.
I think our dad hates this movie probably. But I'll tell you...
It is completely illogical.
It's totally...
He doesn't like Matthew Broderick at all, though.
No. But as an adult, I've moved away from being irritated by it and just kind of understood that, like I've been saying... all of these movies have a fantasy element. This is truly the fantasy of this movie, that you could feasibly do all of these things
before
during a school day.
Before 6, yeah.
Like,
yeah. Going to the baseball game
would take all day.
That's a 3 to 4 hour thing right there.
Yeah.
Is the baseball game. So, yeah. And baseball games, even in Chicago, they normally start 12:30 or 1 o'clock. I mean, that's... really eating into your time, and they were having lunch then.
And hadn't they already gone to the museum too? And who's to say they even got on the road before like 10:30, 11? Because Ferris was coaxing Cameron out of bed for a good long time.
Oh, okay.
So, and who knows how far they live outside of Chicago? It could have taken them a good half hour, 45 minutes to drive there. I mean, there were just so many little. But again. I don't get irritated by this stuff anymore. I just kind of look at it and go, ha, 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 yeah, this is just a complete fantasy that they.
When
could
you get
possibly...
old, your heart dies.
Exactly.
Exactly. You get me away by clocks.
I had the complete opposite experience.
You liked it as a kid and you don't like it as a grown-up?
Exactly. I think I liked it more younger, and the more I watch it, the more it bothers me.
I like it the same.
Good. I mean, I still find it funny, and I still get entertained by it, but, like, for example, I'm rewatching it, and what is the first thing I notice is, like, wow, mathematically, like, logically, I'm looking at when they're taking attendance in his first class, and then they're going to, like, another class. So, in this time frame, one class has passed by. He wore six outfits. Six different outfits in that...
Does that, like, include his German clarinet outfit?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So, in the time... So, he took a shower and changed his clothes into different outfits, like, five or six times within an hour.
And who is that like, Matt, that you also like? You just saw them play. The lead singer, he likes to change.
That's different. That's for a show. that's different. That's like doing costume changes for a number. That's totally different. My point is,
it's great too. They're both great.
What kid is pretending to be sick and wearing six different outfits in an
hour?
He's
a fun guy.
So, like, to your point, ridiculousness and everything like that needs to be set aside. I guess I probably just didn't care about that stuff as a kid because I was just like, wow, this is a creative fantasy kind of thing.
It's a comedy.
Now I look at it and I'm like, wow, I know this is a movie, but that's really improbable that he would do that.
He did write it in 6 days.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So.
Can we talk about the scene when he's trying to coax Garen out of the house?
You're not dying. You just don't have anything better to do.
I'm Cameron. I am not Ferris.
Same.
Oh, actually, I'm Cameron.
I don't know. Actually, I don't
he's
know
my
any,
favorite.
I don't know any Ferrises. I don't think I know any. Maybe there's some people that have touches of Ferris, but really, Ferris Bueller's an asshole.
He rides the line. He is, but he's not so bad. Like
he's got that like intense risk taker quality. Like he's got almost like an Evel Knievel kind of quality where he is not afraid of consequences.
But it's not Bender level though.
He feels like he can outsmart anybody. And this
He's pretty smart.
So we kind of go to a larger discussion. I mean, we can keep talking about Ferris, but specifically a larger discussion. What did adults do to John Hughes?
I know.
John Hughes hates adults.
He had a hard adolescence.
He thinks adults are one of two things, complete idiots or complete monsters. Like, there is no in between.
Well, I think it's that eyes of the teenager thing again, though, too.
Yeah, eyes of the teenager. Yeah. I think he connects really, you know, when he was writing these six movies, he was really at that, you know, he really kind of connected within these stories. He really connected with the teenagers. And yes, some of it is kind of a fantasy.
Incredible fantasy. Come on, Matt.
In some ways.
I mean, these are almost, this is like a similar level of fantasy as like Better Off Dead.
Kind of. I will say this though, when we were talking about 16 Candles, like how things are kind of exaggerated, maybe because it's through the eyes of Samantha.
Yeah.
Maybe that things are kind of exaggerated in this movie because they're through the eyes of Cameron.
Jack said the same thing. And that maybe it's even...
I like that, Jack.
That maybe this isn't even something that happened. This is just Cameron is depressed and in bed the whole day. And this is just an imagination he's having.
I don't think it's an imagination.
He'll keep calling me.
But like the whole idea, like I bet, like you know, Ferris is calling him, and he's in bed, like sick, and doesn't want to leave, and he's in his like cold, really medical looking house and all museum house and everything, and you know, Ferris is calling him. He's like, I bet Ferris is at a luau right now. He's just sitting there in his shorts, drinking Mai Tais, and then all of a sudden he's just going to change magically into another outfit and play his clarinet. But he's going to keep calling me, and he's going to call me, and he's just going to, you know. I agree there are some definite kinds of craziness in this movie.
Yeah.
But I think that I think that
that's part of the
fun. We were all talking. I mean, we're all talking about like who we relate to the most as like being Cameron.
Yeah.
And not knowing someone like Ferris. I think it's really
We're a room full of Bryans and
Camerons. I mean, I think it's kind of it's kind of like, you know, Cameron is friends with Ferris for even though he tortures or whatever.
He loves it.
Because there are times when Ferris gets Cameron away from the shit that depresses him. Yeah. I mean, he ends up having at the end of this movie a really fun, great, you know, day that is not even though he is stressed the entire time
his about parents the are car, really controlling.
Whether they're going to get caught, all this stuff. I mean, by the time it was like halfway through the day and they had made it through like sneaking into the restaurant and like pretending that the cops were there and everything like that, they shouldn't have given a shit if they got caught.
I feel like he first looks the most relaxed when they're at the game. And he's going like, hey, about it. Like, he looks like he's finally kind of like...
Yeah, yeah.
Chilled out.
But,
he must have had one of those hot dogs you were talking about earlier.
Chicago dog. When I go to Wrigley, I'm going to eat one.
There you go.
Has dill pickles, not relish.
Yes. And I think whole tomato, like, slices of tomato.
It's a thing.
It's a thing. It's a Chicago-style hot dog.
Okay.
He's definitely, I think, the one we all relate to the most.
Yeah.
And he needs, and like I said, he needs Ferris.
And, you know, Ferris says multiple times, he isn't doing these crazy adventures this day for himself. Like, he wanted to make sure Cameron had a day like this.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he knows this is the last time he gets to do this, otherwise he's gonna have to do summer school, or something really bad is gonna happen, because it's his senior year. He's, you know, he's gotta be really good, and, you know, what was his quote? You know, life happens really fast.
Life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you might just miss it.
Yeah, so...
Which is not bad advice. I mean, it is kind of that...
It's great advice.
Stop and, you know, smell the roses kind of thing, you know, and really kind of look at what's out there and enjoy it, and not just, you know, get bogged down by your job or school or whatever. Just kind of... And it's not a terrible way to think about things, you know, it's good, but at the same time, you know, I think one of the things that also kind of bothers me about this movie, and then I read online, someone had pointed this out, like he complains about not getting a car, totally understandable, freedom, he doesn't get that freedom, whatever, he ends up doing stuff on that computer that he got, which has probably cost as much or more than the car he got at that time.
Oh, yeah.
The sound machine thing is actually the thing that I think cost the most.
Probably. I mean,
it's like $8,000 or something.
He had a lot of cool stuff. And, you know, he really had, like, he might not have had the freedom of a car to go out, which is probably what he wanted. But he had a lot of cool stuff to, like, keep himself busy, do these things. I mean, he learned how to hack into the school's computer and change.
You know why? Because his older cousin, David, from Seattle...
There you go.
...probably taught him how to do that.
Exactly. Exactly.
War games.
Yeah. So, yeah. There's one thing, you know, to reference a previous episode of our show, when he's on the phone with the freshman and he's at the keyboard making sounds, he goes, they're like, wow, how bad is it? He's like, well, did you ever see that movie Alien? When the thing burst out. It's kind of like that. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. Well, I mean, I guess one of my problems with Ferris, he's just this insane compulsive liar. I mean, he has got everybody fooled.
Well, and he's doing it, it's different than, like, Ally Sheedy's character that is compulsively lies in Breakfast Club. Like, he's doing it for jokes, for, like, pranks. He's not doing it for, you know...
He's not doing it out of malice.
No, he's not malicious.
He's not, but I mean,
he's hurting anybody.
He's got everybody so manipulated. I mean, that everybody thinks that he's either, like, in the hospital or needs a new kidney.
Which is hilarious.
And then, like, the English department sent get well flowers.
I don't know how much of that stuff, though, was him. I think it was the game of telephone, and then it all started becoming, like, you know.
That's the thing. It's like he has this reputation of just being this, like, the fact that
everyone loves him, Nancy.
The fact that Charlie Sheen and his drugs Is that why you're here? Drugs. As when she reveals that Ferris Bueller's her brother, and he's like, "Oh, you know him?" It's like, how does this random guy?
That is the underlying thing in that movie that makes it so funny, though.
Everyone knows him.
There's a band called Save Ferris.
I know. It's crazy.
Well, and did you know Charlie Sheen stayed up for 2 days for that to do that scene?
He stayed awake
for 2 days,
so he'd have like all. So he'd look the
like
red eyes
old, like and... jacked up, yeah.
And then he just kept that look forever.
Yeah. Charlie Estevez.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think that as I've watched this movie over time, and I agree with you, like, there are things that, like, he doesn't do these things to be malicious. He just does it to, like, get out of his, to avoid responsibility.
He's a teenager.
Yeah.
And he's doing it to avoid responsibility.
Authority. And he and Bender have more in common than you think.
So, I wasn't sure how I was going to tie this into this discussion, okay. But there was a show on the USA Network in, like, the early 90s. And I think, like, one summer I was home and it was on every day. So I caught like every episode of it. And I had read before that it was inspired by Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And it was called Parker Lewis Can't Lose.
Oh, yeah.
And
I used to watch it.
And
was Jennifer Aniston in that?
I don't know.
I think so.
I don't know.
Parker Posey?
I don't know. No, it's called Parker Lewis Can't.
No, I know.
I don't know if it was Parker.
But anyway, in the show, he is kind of this, like, problem-solving, like, I can help you get what you want kind of guy, where, and everyone kind of loves him, and, like, the principal doesn't like him.
I believe it was based on it.
It is.
Yeah.
And occasionally he references, like, his pro, like, the person he would look up to.
Protégé, yeah.
And the very last scene of the very last episode, they're in like a cafeteria or something, like, or a theater at the school, and it's panning out, and it pans behind the back of a person, so all you see is like the back of them, and it's Ferris Bueller.
Oh, interesting.
And so it definitely connected the fact that this show was inspired by it. And I always thought that was cool, but I think the cool thing about it was, if this is how Ferris was supposed to be, and this is how everyone kind of liked him, it wasn't necessarily because everyone felt bad for him. I think that throughout his high school career, he made a reputation for himself of using this, like, manipulative power to help all the other people.
Yeah, you got that kid out of summer school.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah. There was one kid that said he's going to help me again.
And here is this day where it's this beautiful day and he's trying, and now he's finally like really trying to help his best friend.
Yeah. Who's pretty desperate.
So if you look at it that way, it really, That's how I see it. I kind of really see it like, this is the day where he actually gets to take a break from all that other shit. You know, he's helping everybody and everyone loves him and everything like that. And now he gets to like go and just have a lot of fun. I mean the of all the ridiculous things in this movie, the one that bothers me the most and is like the most cringeworthy for me is the parade scene. I hate the parade scene. I hate the donkashane. I hate the twist and shout. I hate all the footage of all the people dancing.
I hate the bride. I hate the groom.
It drives me crazy. It makes me uncomfortable watching it.
Why?
Because it's so asinine.
What makes it so asinine?
Because it would never happen.
They have that parade every year.
And honestly, what would have happened in this movie?
I mean,
the museum scene and the parade scene are my favorite scenes in this movie.
You know who else does not like the parade scene for a specific reason? I don't know if he feels this way still. Apparently, the twist and shout they do, which is the Beatles version of the song, and they add all of the, you know, parade music in the band, Paul McCartney feels there's way too much brass in that version of Twist and Shout.
Oh, I agree. I agree with you, Paul.
I think he's a killjoy, is what I think. I found that so funny. I was like, what?
No, and so I think weird. That's like an iconic scene, but it just drives you crazy. I think that if we're looking at favorite scenes.
There's real people in that scene, too.
The museum scene.
The museum scene is great. It has all this great art in it.
And it has a cover of Please, Please, Please Let Me Get What I Want in the background.
So, fun fact, as Cure fans, that scene, that's the instrumental. No, I know that. Okay. No, just listen.
Can't finish.
The scene, the music, the instrumental they play when they're in the museum. Robert Smith wrote an instrumental for that scene, and he just didn't get it done in time or something, and it didn't get put in the movie.
Aww.
Yeah.
I mean, the music in that scene is great.
I was like, whoa, the Seurat painting. And that's I love that, how Cameron just loses it, the pointillism. He's just staring at it like, what?
I've been there, and I stood in front of that painting.
Which is awesome.
There you go. Yeah. Well, I love the museum scene, but I love the scene when it's at the end and he's racing to get home.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
And he's, like, running through the houses and stuff. And then in the Spider-Man Homecoming movie, they do an homage to that.
Oh, awesome.
Where he's, like, doing a lot of the same kind of stuff at night while he's chasing one of the villains. And I just, that, the scene with, in Ferris Bueller's Day Off when they do it, it just seems so, like, how is he, like, jumping over all the stuff? And he's like, I love it when he runs through the house. He's like, dinner's ready. Mmm, smells delicious. Yeah. He's just like,
he hurt himself doing all that stuff.
Oh, I'm sure. I mean, he probably tripped a million times. So, I just, and it's well shot, too. It's like, a lot of it's kind of done in one shot.
Where
it's
cool.
He's just running through everything, and that's a cool scene.
So, the museum scene is your favorite scene, yeah, is what you said.
I think the museum scene is my, I mean, I love going to museums, but just everything about that scene.
It's very nice.
And if I had to pick one thing that they had done all day, that would have probably been the thing I would have wanted to do.
I guess John Hughes used to go to that museum a lot, so he wanted to bring that into the movie.
I bet.
That's very nice.
I think I've also been to that super tall building we were in.
The Sears Tower?
Yeah.
Well, good for you.
Pretty sure. Pretty sure. I don't know if I...
Did you lean over the glass?
No, I was there at night, and I don't remember leaning over the glass. But I think I remember, like, looking out, and it was pretty crazy.
Did you go to Wall Street and, like, make all the hand motions and everything? Like,
no, that was very fun. Cameron. I'll say what's fun about watching this movie now also is that there was a show that I got completely obsessed with over the summer and early fall called Succession, and Alan Ruck plays the oldest sibling in that family. So to get to see Alan Ruck again, you know, at this age where, you know, it's 33 years after Ferris Bueller came out, it's a lot of fun. And he's also hilarious in that show, so.
I think he was also on Spin City.
He was on Spin City.
And I don't know if it was only when Michael J. Fox was on it.
I don't know.
And then, he's a pretty good actor. You know, I like him. The chick who plays...
You're my hero, Ferris.
Well, God, if he was 29 when that came out, he's pretty up there now.
I love Jennifer Grey in this, too, though. She gets. She's so great.
Well, I mean, and then Charlie Sheen's character's like,
oh, it's
why
wonderful.
Don't you ditch, too?
Right?
If you're so mad at him because I'd get caught. Well, that's your problem, then, isn't it? But, I mean, I can kind of understand her frustration.
Like, oh, sure.
Because, and it's not just she's frustrated that he keeps breaking the rules and gets away with it. It's more that it seems like her parents have this insane blind spot for Ferris because he has snowed them for so long. Yet
and she gets shit on all the time.
Exactly. Like she...
I totally get why she's pissed.
You know, we don't actually see her getting punished for very much other than the cops picking her up for making a phony phone call, supposedly. But she's clearly got years of built up angst with watching Ferris be able to be this, like, magician, being able to manipulate everybody, and she just doesn't have that same quality, and it pisses her off.
Well,
because if she could get away with it, she probably would.
Right. Well, in a lot of families, the girls are scrutinized more than the guys are, too.
Yeah.
But, I mean, in the end...
I know.
I never noticed that.
It's true. Girls are always treated different.
I never noticed.
Yeah. Okay.
In the end, it's just... It's the best, though, when she totally just defends him to Rooney, and she's just like, you know...
Thanks for bringing him home.
Yeah.
Can you believe he was going to walk home from the hospital?
So great.
You dropped your wallet. And this was pre-Dirty Dancing.
Yes.
And I believe I saw this before I ever saw Dirty Dancing, so I didn't watch this with a, oh, she plays baby. Oh, I liked her so much in that. I want to be on her side for this. No, I mean, I probably was irritated with her just as much as Ferris when I was a kid watching this. But as an adult, it's like, yeah, I understand why she's irritated.
Oh, yeah.
I get it.
One of my favorite lines in this movie is at the end, when the parents are home, but they're having a conversation just outside the door, like on the porch, right after Jeannie has like gotten like 2 speeding tickets and like papers are flown all over like that. The mom is all mad and like saying, like pouring her heart out to her husband, and the dad just goes, I think we should shoot her.
Do you know they got married in real life?
Yeah,
the
but they,
didn't,
yeah, they got married though. After the movie, and then it only lasted a couple
funny.
Years.
I know, but it's still funny.
Did you know that the only reason why Charlie Sheen is in this movie is because Jennifer Grey was in Red Dawn with him and then said, hey, I know this guy, Charlie Sheen, and told John Hughes, and that's how he got in the movie.
And it wasn't because John Hughes asked Emilio Estevez, oh, do you know anyone that could play this druggy guy? Oh, yeah, my brother. Why
my
don't
brother, who
him?
Does not have the same last name as me.
Yeah. Nia Sarah is married to Brian Henson. I did not know that.
Who's that?
Jim Henson's son.
Jim Henson's son.
Mm-hmm.
And Snow. She was in Legend, which didn't have puppets, too?
Yeah. I think it had some.
There you go.
Legend's a great movie. It's a fun movie. I mean,
Tom Cruise
it's
is
not,
in that, Matt.
It's not my favorite movie.
But evil Tim Curry's in it, too.
Yeah, I mean,
he is very scary in that movie.
You know what's funny?
I mean, I need to watch that.
He does not even look like him, though.
Well, no, he's like painted like a red devil kind of character.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. But, yeah, Tom Cruise is in that movie. I don't know how much he's running in that movie, though.
I don't remember either.
Your annoyance with him has increased in the last 10 years.
You know what? It's I've always had like a...
I know you have, but
it's
I think
on, it's
increased.
On, it's like the ultimate movie for me to not watch has Tom Cruise, Nicolas Cage, and Sandra Bullock in it. I mean that's a movie not for me. But anyway,
two of those people won like Best Actor Oscars at one point.
It just goes to show how flawed the system is.
Sandra and Nicolas Cage.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if Tom. I don't think Tom Cruise has ever won a Best Actor Academy Award.
Well, maybe was it the award for best actor who runs?
The MTV,
runs
so,
a lot.
The MTV
runs
Movie
a lot.
Awards. He won.
Anyway,
some. Yeah. So you guys know that Matt and I like clearly got into it as siblings in the last episode, but that's why I think it's entertaining that two of the three John Hughes movies this
yeah.
week really do show some sibling rivalries. I
Absolutely.
Mean, and I mean,
especially Ferris and Jeannie.
Especially
okay.
Ferris, because Ferris just. Like, when she saw him and, like, her eyes, like, narrowed, and she that's when she, like, is racing to beat him home. I mean, she's just like, he's got to get caught. There's just no way he can keep getting away with this.
I think, though, if we're going to kind of, if we're okay with opening the floor a little
yeah.
bit, I'd like to say that of the teen 80s John Hughes comedies, the biggest sibling rivalry was in Weird Science. Between Chet, played by Bill Paxton, and then
I haven't seen it enough.
Dwight, I think his name's Dwight.
Yeah.
Wyatt.
Yeah.
Who, and you know Chet's constantly being.
I don't know
treating
how.
Him like
I don't.
Crap,
but
though.
I think Chet's not. I would say. I mean, I could be wrong. Bill Paxton's character.
Yes.
I don't think he was a teenager. I think he was
no,
in his
he
early
was like,
20s. So it's almost like not. It's not really the same, because it's not like they're both in high school together, or one is just a little older. I feel
yeah, they
like...
they clearly did not get along.
Oh, no.
I mean, at one
he
point...
He gets turned into a pile of shit.
Yes.
So...
I think of those 6 movies, that clearly is the most, fantasy kind
they
of
create
movie.
A woman. Of course it's a fantasy.
They create a woman
I mean,
who
they're
has
not
superpowers.
Talking, it's not like they're talking about plastic surgery. It's
no.
just like, create a woman from a Barbie doll.
Right, what do you two little maniacs want to do first?
Oh my god. But another Anthony Michael Hall movie.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean,
it's a fun movie.
I think that one is good. I've seen it a bunch of times. It's definitely bizarre and weird. Not bizarre in like a David Lynch bizarreness, but bizarre in a sense that like it has some fantasy elements to
a
it.
A lot of fantasy.
And then during the Pretty in Pink episode, we also mentioned Some Kind of Wonderful. If you were to rank those 6 movies, which one would be your favorite and which one's your least favorite? Because I really like all of them for different reasons.
Yeah.
And I know it, we haven't didn't really recently rewatch Weird Science or Some Kind of Wonderful. And Some Kind of Wonderful has definitely kind of a different look and a little bit of a different pacing and vibe because John didn't direct it.
And it doesn't have his normal cast. It's got Eric Stoltz, Leah Thompson,
Mary Sue Masterson.
Yeah, it's got like a different set of actors. It's not pulling from the same kind of brat pack that he normally was using.
And I'll make this easy. Is like you almost can't compare them too much because
they're all so different.
They're all pretty different. I mean, I think the three Molly Ringwald ones, but regardless of the fact that she's in all three of them, those three have like the most similar tone to where you could rank those.
Yeah.
Whereas Ferris Bueller, Weird Science, and Some Kind of Wonderful are all kind
they're
of...
They're so different.
They're very different.
I'm not going to pick a favorite. I mean, I think it really just depends on the mood. I mean, Breakfast Club is maybe the best one out of all those, but I don't know. I think it just depends on the mood, because if I'm in more of like a romantic movie mode, then I'd watch something different.
Would you watch Pretty in Pink then?
Probably.
Or 16 Candles?
Either Pretty in Pink or maybe Some Kind of Wonderful, actually.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it's hard. They're all very unique. And again, it's not like either... They're not sequels. They're just... They're all their own unique story. So it just depends. Yeah, I'm not picking a favorite.
Good.
I abstain.
No, well, I mean, I just think that it's an interesting idea to think of. It's like those movies really kind of stand on their own. I mean,
and I'm sure there's people that have much clearer favorites than we do.
Well, I mean, if I was to just blanketly be like, which movie of those six do you like the most? I'm going to say Breakfast Club.
Yeah.
Because I've watched it the most.
Mm-hmm.
When it's on, I can stop channel surfing and watch it. I think that it's the most relatable because it has the different characters. So, you know, I would say that, I mean, of those six, probably my least favorite.
Ferris Bueller.
I have kind of like more of a personal connection with, I'm only going to say Some Kind of Wonderful.
You're doing like 80s teen John Hughes.
Just those just six 80s. Okay. Those six.
Cause I was going to say there's
teen,
a lot more than
I, 80s teen. I mean,
okay.
Worst Curly Sue. I don't know. I never saw that.
I saw it in the theater.
Never saw Curly Sue. But I would say only Some Kind of Wonderful because...
Is your least favorite?
Is my least favorite. Oh, because
it's I thought you liked it more than Pretty in Pink.
You probably just haven't seen it as much.
I haven't seen it as much.
That's how I feel.
I just feel like I haven't seen it as much. And if I'm looking at, like, why haven't I seen it as much, it's probably because it's probably the least popular of all of those.
It's got a male lead, too.
It's got the male lead, so it's a little different. Well, but Weird Science... I would say Weird Science has male leads.
Yes.
But then you put Kelly LeBrock. Then you put Kelly LeBrock in there, and...
She's like a goddess in that
movie. You can just spend the whole movie looking at Kelly LeBrock, so...
Former Mrs. Steven Seagal, I think.
Interesting. Wow.
I think so.
Funny tale.
I have to fact check that now. Sorry.
His loss.
I'm saying Christmas Vacation. Oh wait.
Well, the 80s teen. Only the 80s teen ones.
I honestly would have to really think.
Christmas Vacation is a great Christmas movie. I never really watched it that much until you and I got together. But I gotta say, it has really grown on me.
Primarily because I've never seen it.
And you will.
Yeah, I can't wait.
You will.
And
Was married to Steve.
Yeah, I love Uncle Buck is great. I've never been a fan of Home Alone.
Yeah.
And it's not. And I get why people like Home Alone. I don't like the whole.
You're not
like,
as into physical comedy.
I'm not as into physical comedy.
Me neither.
And like hurting people, stuff like that.
But you know, I have a feeling that your son will laugh at that movie, won't we?
Oh, of course. I mean, I think that's where John Hughes, you know, his career kind of started changing. He started doing more, I mean, the Beethoven movies, all of that was more kid-friendly.
Right.
So.
I'd say.
So of those six.
You're right, right. Jokes aside. Breakfast Club is probably my favorite, but I really like Ferris Bueller, too. So.
All right, then those two.
But. Yeah, but I like them all. Like you said, it's hard.
It just depends on your mood.
I think I also gained more of an appreciation for 16 Candles watching it this time.
I have to say...
I think the music in 16 Candles is by far the best out of the three movies we watched this week.
Yeah. I always enjoy watching it, but lately when I haven't seen it for a while, and before we watched it, I was feeling like, I don't think I'm as into this movie.
16 Candles.
I thought I wasn't. Like, I thought maybe I had, like, not, I wouldn't be as much anymore. I think I like it more now than I ever did.
Yeah, it's funny.
Which is the opposite of how I thought I felt. So
even though funny. We both now have the friend or family member getting married the day before our birthday's experience, now we can super identify with this movie.
One of the parts in that movie I have to say that I love so much is when she's leaving the wedding and she just starts taking off like her pantyhose and stuff. And she's like, get these off. Cause she's just like, so just jacked up on these muscle relaxers. Like she just throws the veil and it like lands on the flout. It's so funny.
Kicks her shoe off and it has the whistle as like the extra sound effect. And then her dress is like caught in the car door. Yeah. She's a mess.
Yeah.
She is a mess.
I have a long sweater that I wear to work sometimes. And it's definitely, somebody had to point out to me that it was stuck out of the car. Door. Yeah. So now I have to make sure I pull it into the car.
It happens. It happens. But, well, this was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And thank you again, Sherry, for joining us.
It's always a pleasure.
I'd like to, did you have something to say?
I was just going to say, I watched all three of these movies in a 24-hour period.
It's impressive.
Which is a lot of fun to do. Mm-hmm. It's like, all right, I'm powering through.
That was with work.
That was with work, but with a lot of coffee. A lot of coffee to keep me awake to watch all of them. And to wake up super early to watch them.
I'd like to admit that it was really nice that I got to catch up on Breakfast Club before we recorded the podcast. Because I fell asleep for like 20 minutes rewatching Breakfast Club.
It's okay.
Because I watched it way too late.
Yeah, well, that's what we do.
It's life. Say, Lovey, we're dedicated to this podcast, though, and we want to make sure that we can
squeezing it in when we can.
We are very excited for everyone who listens to us. We did hit a milestone after we posted our last episode, and we're all very happy about this and very grateful to everyone who listens. We hit 1,000 total downloads of our podcast, which. Nancy, with her finance background, was checking
diligently
the numbers, and it was fun watching her excitement.
She was so excited. And, I love it.
You know, we couldn't have done that with all of you listeners, so thank you very much. We really appreciate you guys getting us there. And we're approaching another milestone pretty soon, our 25th episode. So when we get there, we're going to be, that's going to be really special for us, too.
Yay.
So thank you, Sherry, for being a listener and contributor. You are an excellent guest, and we really appreciate it. Thank you, Nancy, for powering through those movies in 24 hours. I think that was really great. And
thank you, Matthew, for wanting to do the podcast originally back in January, proposing the idea.
Well,
could keep it going.
You wanted to learn how to edit. And now you're doing a great job.
Thank you.
So, and again, we want to thank Joan and John Cusack for being in 16 Candles. And,
I wonder what their favorite John Hughes movie is.
They're so fun in that movie.
Probably that one.
Maybe. Maybe not.
Maybe not.
Yeah.
Maybe they have a soft spot for one of the other ones.
Maybe we can ask them someday. You know, just a quick, quick couple questions. Hey, favorite John Hughes movie? Go.
Yeah.
There you go. And if you're out there and you enjoy our podcast, please rate us on Apple Podcasts or Spotify.
It's not that hard, people.
Thanks, Sherry.
Thanks, Sherry. And And follow us online. You know where to follow us. And if you don't, that's okay. Just search for Fighting Over the VCR. There's not many out there. And again,
yeah, VCRs don't exist anymore. Blockbuster is gone. The last one finally closed in somewhere in Oregon, I think.
Oh, it closed? I think it's the only one that was open.
It's hard to even find stores that have DVDs that you can rent or anything like that anymore. So, again, thank you, everybody. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
We're out.
Bye.